Hello everybody and welcome to another video tutorial by Vivio Technologies. Today we're going to be talking about setting up websites in IIS and how to troubleshoot the website if it's throwing an IIS specific error. For our video purpose, we're going to use example.com, and as you see, we're currently getting the default IIS web page, which is to be expected since we don't have the site configured in IIS yet. So let's go ahead and open IIS Manager to go ahead and get this site created. There's several different ways to open IIS Manager. The first option is to click on the Start menu and then go to Windows Administrative Tools. And in the list of tools, you should see the option for Internet Information Services. Double click on that option or right click and choose Open, and that should open IIS Manager. Another option is to click on the Start menu and type IIS Manager and find the option listed. You can right click it and choose pin to start or pin taskbar if you want to make it easily accessible in the future. So if I click on the start menu now, it should show in my pinned options. You can also open it through a command prompt using start inet manager. Now the IIS manager is open, you want to expand the server node and go to your list of websites by clicking on sites. We don't currently have any custom website set up, so we're going to create our first website for example.com. And to do that, you just click on the Add Website button here under the Actions pane. And then in the dialog, it's going to ask you what your site name should be. This does not have to be the fully qualified domain name that you're going to be browsing to on a daily basis. This could be something that just references what that is. But for me, I personally recommend having it the same as the domain name, just so I know what it's related to. It just makes it easier. As you saw, whenever I was typing out the domain, the application pool does automatically fill in with the same name you use for the site name. So the application pool handles all the different custom settings, .NET version, your ASP.NET pipeline mode, what authenticated user that your application is using, rapid fail protection settings. All these different types of settings can be configured on the application level. So the application pool is super important. By default, it's creating its own application pool. But if you click on the select button here, you can choose a pre-existing application pool, and you can set the application pool to be used by multiple sites. But I personally recommend just separating each website to its own application pool, so that way each site can have its own configurable settings that won't mess up any of the other sites. So the physical path option here is going to be the folder that your website files live. So you will need to have a location on the server. As you see, I already have a folder under C websites, example.com, htdocs. You don't have to have your website files uploaded yet. You just need to have a folder created that is going to eventually host those website files. So copy and paste that physical path there. You can also choose the dot 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 option and browse it this way. The IIS bindings for the website, whenever you are creating your website, it only allows you to create one binding initially, but we'll show you how to create additional ones. So don't worry about the fact that we're not using www.example.com. We're just going to create the base example.com HTTP binding and then click OK to get that created. So the website is now created, and if we select it and choose bindings, this is where you can set the additional fully qualified domain names that you want to be able to be loading this website that we just created. For example, the www version that we just mentioned. And then click OK once you add your new binding. Now you can add additional types. You can add a HTTPS binding, which is going to be the secure version of your website. We'll go over that in the another guide, but that just allows you to be able to have a secure version of your website that's using a SSL certificate that just encrypts the traffic from the user's web browser to the server, and prevents any attackers that's listening on the network from being able to grab data that's in transition. Now that our website is created, we can go over to the application pools. And since we created our own application pool in the steps that we did when we first created the website earlier, you can see the example.com has been created. We can select that and then choose advanced settings. This is where you can change your .NET version, the ASP.NET pipeline mode, whether it's running in 32-bit mode, things of those nature. You can also scroll down to the bottom and you can set limits for the application pool, how much memory it can use. By default, it's allowed to use as much as is needed, but if you find that this website is really causing issues on the server for other websites or anything of that nature, you can come in here and set limits so that way the application pool does not consume more than you you want it to. You can also do the same thing for CPU as well. But once you set your settings, you can click OK and that should save. You can also come in here and click Recycle, and that will recycle the application pool and it will pull in all the new settings. Now that our website is configured, we should be able to come back over to our browser and click the refresh, and that should load our website, and it does. So it shows the welcome to the test site. So our website is configured and loading properly, but if you are receiving a IIS specific error whenever going to a website or a specific URL on your website, and it doesn't show really good detailed information to let you know what the error is actually what actually is throwing the error, you can come into IIS and click on Sites and then find your website in question and double click it. And then under the IIS section, click on the error pages. And now you can click on the edit feature settings and choose detailed errors. What that does is allows the website to show detailed errors instead of just the generic 404 or generic 500 error. It shows more information on why it received that error and may help you be able to figure out how to resolve it. If you have any issues resolving, you can always contact our support team. Once you do finish troubleshooting the error, I do recommend coming in here and choosing Edit Feature Settings and then set this back to Detailed Errors for Local Request Only. What this does is it prevents attackers from being able to see more detailed errors on your website that you may not want them to be able to have. It may compromise your system security if the attacker knows more information than they should about your web server configuration. But by default, that is already set to detailed local errors only. So just make sure that gets set back correctly and you should be good to go.